and it's open to a whole range of different interpretations, but is widely seen as prohibiting Ahmadis from publicly practicing their beliefs and maybe even having any form of public presence. In other words, they can have the beliefs, but they have to do it in secret, it seems to be what it says. It's very unclear. It also prohibits the community from carrying out undefined illegal actions against the Ahmadis, and basically stop killing them, which has completely failed, because there have been a whole series of increasingly aggressive attacks against Ahmadi communities that resulted in deaths and serious injuries to Ahmadis in destruction of their properties. Now, I need to say a little bit about the context of this. This was released on the 9th of June 2008, and that was 7 days after the so-called Monas tragedy. This was when a peaceful rally of people calling for religious tolerance and freedom in Indonesia, which had people from a whole range of religious groups and organisations, right across all the six major religions, including many Muslims, who had a family day to protest against religious intolerance. And this was attacked by Islamist vigilante groups who are, I think it's fair to say, associated with the Front Pembela Islam. Front Pembela Islam is certainly there. They probably didn't organise the attack directly, but there was associated, their groups associated with FPI. There's a lot of argument about that, but I think some of the organisations were set up on the day for the, you know, just for that attack, but they were certainly within that group of vigilante organisations linked to Front Pembela Islam, Islam Independence Front. And they attacked this rally with bamboo sticks, powdered glass, swords, caused a lot of injury. And one of the reasons for that attack was that, in particular, the protesters at that rally were calling for tolerance of the Ahmadis, among other things. So the Ahmadi issue was a flashpoint for that attack. It was very violent. Some prominent moderate Muslim leaders, for example, very very high profile ones like Shafi Anwar and so forth, were very seriously injured and hospitalised, although not killed. Anyway, that happened 7 days before this decision was released, and following it there were a series of demonstrations, and on the day the rally was released, decision was released, outside the building where the decision was being drafted, there were demonstrations and protests. Now, I've interviewed the people who drafted this document, some of them, and you know, they talk about sitting in the building looking outside at the demonstrations and rallies outside and a sense of real intimidation and fear. One of them has spoken about being concerned that he wouldn't be able to get out of the building and worried about their own safety. So this was in a real pressure cooker, high tension situation. There'd been this riot and this violent attack on families, and now the building in which this was being drafted was surrounded by protesters, quite aggressive. So there was a lot of fighting within the group, disagreement within the group as they were drafting it. And some of the drafters have since said they were not happy with what they'd written, that they made a mistake with some of it, they should have been clearer, they went too far. Certainly they said that they were in a state of somewhat of panic to get something out to defuse the situation. However, having said that, in the end, what they produced, that document I've just described there, was not really particularly different to a whole series of other decisions that already had been produced in the past. And this is not widely known. It actually reiterated a decision produced in 2010 by the Minister of Dalam Negeri for Internal Affairs, and a whole lot of regulations since the 1970s about the Ahmadis. In fact, it wasn't new. This was a reiteration of a series of prohibitions on the Ahmadis. And since then, local governments, including West Java, East Kalimantan, South Sumatra, East Java, have all issued similar regulations against the Ahmadis. But I think it's important to understand the context in which this was reiterated. Now, what gave them the power to do this? The blasphemy law, upheld by the Constitutional Court, Article 28J2 of the Constitution for public order, morality, etc. And a recommendation on the 16th of April 2008 from a group called Bakor Paken. Now, Bakor Paken is the coordinating agency for monitoring social beliefs in Indonesia, or beliefs in society. This was set up by the Jaksa Agung, the public prosecutor, to monitor beliefs, meaning kepercayaan. Again, look at the wording. For reasons of public security and order, same words as in 28J2, and to coordinate with other agencies. And it was specifically authorised by the law on the prosecution service. So that's the basis for Bakwatbakim. That law, the constitution, the blasphemy law. It's a coordinating body that includes a public prosecutor, people from the Ministry of Religion, from Dalam Negeri, Internal Affairs, from Education Department, from the Army, from the police, and from BIN, Indonesia's intelligence agency, are all sitting on Bakwatbakim. And they made a recommendation to the government to outlaw Ahmadiyya, and that gave the authority for the issuing of it in 2010 by that joint committee. That's the sort of process that leads to it. So what could be done for the proponents of greater religious freedom? And, you know, I think the point I'm trying to make in this presentation is that the proponents of religious freedom in Indonesia, in many cases, don't understand that that freedom really doesn't exist in the way they think it does. It has been so constrained by the constitutional court interpretations of 28J2 that the government really has absolute rights to legislate, to do things like the Ahmadiyya. In my view, rightly or wrongly, I'm not expressing a view about the rights and wrongs of it at all. I'm not saying anything about that. But as a matter of law, they clearly have that power. And that is clearly a valid law that can be issued by the government if it chooses to. What happens if the proponents of religious freedom wanted to challenge the Ahmadiyya joint decision, effectively banning public manifestations of Ahmadi beliefs? Well, the Constitutional Court didn't touch on the joint decision in its judgment, and it can't, because the Constitutional Court can only review statutes, that is, laws produced by the National Parliament, the DPR. The Constitutional Court cannot review lower regulations. And I need to just take you through to something quickly here, excuse me. This is the pyramid of laws in Indonesia. This is how it operates. At the top, in the Constitution, decisions of the DPR, statutes of the national legislature. Then you have government regulations, provincial regulations, and local regulations. So, this is a government regulation, or it's actually a lower level of regulation, like that, Constitution will only deal with statutes. Anything below the level of that's right. And that's the same with the Supreme Court. It has to regard these invalid, no matter what they say. It is reviewed against that. The Constitutional Court can review them against that. This is a really serious problem, because it means that regional regulations cannot be reviewed for constitutionality. It's a serious problem in the Indonesian legal system. So the Constitutional Court could never review the joint decree, no matter how, if it was really wrong, it couldn't review it. The Supreme Court doesn't, it could against the statute, but it's clearly in line with the statute. And I might add that the Supreme Court does not like striking down regulations. Very rarely does it ever strike down regulations. It usually just says, oh, what was passed correctly, that's it. So we have a real problem. There's a real problem here about the validity of laws in the review system.